Hello everyone, welcome to Guitar Technique Episode 1. We're doing drills for hand function and control. Well, you know, I want to start this video off by just saying that as guitar players, you know, as we're developing our skills on this instrument, one of the frustrations that often keeps coming up has to do with performing clean, precise executions of each note. And when we're developing this experience, you know, in other words, as a guitar player is playing through their different song parts, performing, you know, whether it's, you know, chord harmony or melody lines, as you're developing this, it takes time and you need to acquire a complete control, a level of high degree of control over your fingers and hand motions. And, you know, when you want to play clearly and cleanly, it means a guitar player has to have a very good balance of their finger motions between left and right hand. Players also need to have an awareness of the strings and exactly where they are so that, you know, any song parts that they're playing are able to be performed with, you know, as flawless of execution as you can possibly have. So this means you need to work on guitar technique. You need drills and exercises that are going to help you perfect what it is that you're doing with those song parts, and that's exactly what this entire course is going to be about. So in part one here, in getting started of this lesson, I want to explore some hand balance ideas, some studies that are going to help you with that, along with some picking and some sustained drills. So let's zoom in on the neck and get this lesson started. In exercise one, we're going to be focusing on upper string study, just working on the first two guitar strings. This is a great place to start if you're just getting into technique for the first time. And our focus here is on left and right hand coordination. It's a paramount skill to develop, obviously, for a good technique. Unfortunately, it's often overlooked by a lot of guitar students, and, you know, ignoring this area of skill development, it just quickly leads the guitarist to frustration. So what we want the hands to be able to do is we want them both to be able to cooperate with one another. So what's happening with our picking hand is going to be able to be tracked perfectly as possible with the other hand, with the fretting hand. And the solution is fairly simple, but it just requires patience and time spent really isolating each hand's movements. Now, in exercise 1A, I have this short melodic statement. It's performed in two positions. The first position is just down low at the nut of the guitar. We have open B, C sharp, D sharp, and then we're going to move up and we're going to take an open E string, an F sharp, and a G. And that's it. Very simple group of notes. And we're just running through them. It's like an ascending scale phrase. And then what we're going to look at doing with that phrase is taking it up an octave so we can get used to having frets closer together. So we're going to go way up at the 12th position now. And we're going to play the same notes. But the thing is, you know, when you're up higher on the neck, the frets are so close together when you're up there that what we're going to be doing for those top notes is we're going to be using index, middle, and ring fingers when we're doing the E, F sharp, G. Because if we use the ring finger and the small finger, it starts bunching the hand up a little bit close. Now, you could do that. You could try it, and you can see what happens with your technical skill. But what you may find a lot more comfortable is using your middle and ring fingers to reach up to the 14th and 15th frets. So these are the simple little things, you know, that you start learning about, you know, in terms of fretting hand, what can be more beneficial to you. And one of the other things that I wanted to mention is a lot of times for just, you know, very new students to technique, they can find tracking an issue. So what's going on with the picking hand and what's going on with the fretting hand, they seem out of sync. And usually what happens with that, the problem is overall that one part of your mind is putting a lot more concentrated effort, a lot more conscious effort on what's going on with one of the hands as opposed to the other. And I've seen it happen with both hands. Sometimes people are paying too much attention to what's going on the fretting hand just because they need to, because they're not aware of what's happening down in that end of those fingers. And then sometimes it's the other hand. Sometimes they're focused so much on what's happening with the picking that what happens is, you know, they kind of flub out and, you know, mess up what's happening with the fretting hand. So my suggestion is to isolate both hands if you're having trouble like that. Go through the notes. You know, I'm going to sort of just imagine that I played the open second string, then move my fingers into that C sharp and D sharp, and then imagine that open first string was played, and then move into the F sharp and the G. So Imagine. You know, do that kind of work. Solidify where the fingers have to go. Because the better that you can become at understanding what the fretting hand has to do, the better if it is going to be for the tracking of both hands. You can do the same thing with scales, and you could learn a scale pattern. You know, let's say it's a major pentatonic. Just move your fingers through it. You know, you don't have to play those notes. You can learn the shape by just focusing on only one hand. And then you can work at tracking with the other. You know, let's say if we go back to our study from example 1A, the picking drill for two positions here. You can cover the strings with the left hand and then use the picking hand to track what has to happen with the picking structure. If you're good at alternate picking, I highly suggest using alternate. If you're not, use all downstrokes. But if you can do alternate, I'd highly suggest moving towards that direction. And then when this hand, you know, the picking hand feels good, and when the fretting hand feels good, and they seem fairly well organized and synchronized, then you can begin building the connection for both. Taking it up higher is going to give you that closer fret region technique building. So that's what I would like you to work on for example or the exercise of 1A. And then what we're going to do for exercise 1B is the melodic phrase that I have in this one is movable. So first what I would suggest doing is learn the phrase as it's written, isolated, you know, for both hands, like in both hands like we just were mentioning there. And then play the phrase up to tempo. And once the phrase is fairly well developed, then move it along the neck laterally. Now, when I say play the phrase up to tempo, you'll notice in the handouts there is no goal tempo given. I didn't say to play this at 52 beats per minute or 68 or 72 or 88 or 120. There's nothing listed. And that's because you're going to have to find your own goal tempos on these. You know, developing technique, I guess the long-term solution is to try to go very quickly. You know, try to go as fast as you can. If you can get these exercises up to 138 beats per minute or something, then do that. If it's very challenging to play them, let's say at 92 beats per minute, then that's maybe your initial baseline for your goal tempo. But after you have some skill with being able to execute the idea, turn that metronome on and get a timekeeping device behind you. And I would probably say for drills like this, I would really stress metronome above drum machine, okay? Let's go into seventh position because example exercise 1B here, it's in the seventh position, traveling on the second string, going 7, 9, 11. And then we're moving up into the first string and we got 7, 9, going back to second string for 11, and then back to the seventh fret on the first guitar string, the B, and then we're heading back over here to this G sharp, and then we're going to have this A sharp or B flat, however you want to look at it, taking us back to this F sharp tone. So we're moving up, going linear on the second string at first, 7, 9, 11, moving to the first string, getting 7 and 9, crossing over to 11 on the second string, back to first string for 7, back to second string for 9, and 11, and then 7. That's the exercise. Now again, if alternate picking is a problem for you, because I know it's challenging for a lot of people in the early days of playing, then do everything downstrokes. Okay, so something like this. But as soon as you can, you know, don't allow yourself to get hung up just always doing downstrokes. Make sure that as soon as you can switch over to start working on alternate picking. And then what the idea would be with this drill is to take it to other positions. Now, if you go down lower towards the headstock, it gets more challenging to play. But if it's, you know, just crazy trying to get down to that end of the neck, maybe what you need to do is take it a little bit higher. Maybe go to ninth position. And then 11th, perhaps. But turn a metronome on and do some work with that. Both of these drills are given in 3/4 time. So, you know, if you're going to turn on a metronome, make sure prior to that metronome coming on, you can count through these things. You know, so let's say in example, exercise 1B, your idea would be like this, to count in 1, 2, 3, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 1, and 2, and 3, 1, and 2, and 3, and 1, and 2, and 3, just like that. You get the idea. So, you know, this idea of working with these kinds of drills is very helpful. You can tell what we're really doing is just working on isolating two strings. Now, you could just take any of what we have talked about for exercise 1A or exercise 1B, and you can transfer them to other string sets. You know, if we go back to exercise 1A, that was maybe the higher one here, for example. So that was that drill that was coming along with whole steps. And then changing strings with a whole step and a half step. And you could take it to other strings in other places. Maybe you could put it down here. Maybe you could put it down here. So this idea is, after you get pretty good at these concepts, you know, you could move them all along and across the fingerboard. Just turn on a metronome. Don't practice them for too long, because you don't want to burn your hand out. You don't want to give yourself any kind of muscle problems, tendonitis, that kind of thing. Just practice it for 2 to maximum maybe of 3 minutes, and then go on to something else. Go, switch up your exercises and, do something different. And of course, the main thing I want to say one more time here with exercise one, as the sort of prelude going forward with all these other exercises, is isolate the hands. Just like I was mentioning, if you could play a scale by just going and isolating your left hand and outlining it. It's like you're doing the geometrical shape of the scale and just, getting it together for that fretting hand. And then thinking too about what has to happen with this picking hand, moving across the neck, giving yourself technical concepts that have to happen so that eventually both hands feel very well synchronized, and you can go, between the two of them, and it feels very balanced. Isolating and getting all your conscious effort toward one hand only, develop that hand skill, think in terms also the other hand, isolate that, all conscious effort on that hand, and then bringing them together, whether it's a scale or a lick or whatever, exercises and the drills that we're doing here, whatever it may be. That kind of work is super helpful. I'm not going to dwell on that too much, anymore in this lesson plan, but I want you to be well aware of that idea, because that isolation work of focusing on only one hand, hyper-conscious level thought where it's very clear, and then focus entirely to the other hand, all efforts on that other hand, and very high level conscious thought, that's what's going to bring everything together for you. And then really what tightens it all up is the use of the metronome and speeding it up faster and faster. So what we're going to do now, take a short break, and then we're going to come back in a moment with exercise 2, where I'm going to start going over some ideas for hand control. We're going to look at picking variations and try to get a little bit of sustain in there as well. So it's going to be a good one in exercise 2. Hang loose, and we'll be right back with that exercise. Hi everybody, Andrew Wasson here from creativeguitarstudio.com. I've been a professional guitarist for over 25 years now, and I've been teaching guitar for even longer than that. But today I want to talk to you about your current situation by discussing the study of guitar and the time that you have available to put into it. If you're like most people, you're working a 9-to-5 job and you're working 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week, that's 160 hours a month. How much free time does that leave you left over to study guitar? Let's say you can maybe fit in an hour or so, around 4 or 5 days in a week when you have the free time. And if that is the case, wouldn't you want to make the most of that 1 hour of study, practicing a highly organized, step-by-step, well-structured guitar curriculum? Without a structured plan, it's pretty easy to waste time. A lot of times it happens by just focusing on playing through a bunch of stuff songs riffs you already know, licks that you're familiar with. But practicing stuff you already know will not make you a better guitar player. You need a constant supply of fresh material. If you practice guitar by just playing stuff you already know, before you realize it, time ticks on, time ticks by, and that valuable period of time that you have every day, it gets lost. If left alone, those hours lost every day turn into lost weeks, lost months, and then eventually lost years of wasted time. You'll still be the same guitar player that you were before because you never challenged yourself. I've seen it dozens and dozens of times in my own studio here. But you can change that. In the valuable time that you do have every day, you can start studying a comprehensive guitar course that'll not only educate you, but it'll turn you into a well-skilled musician. So if you want to learn more, sign up for a free account through my website at creativeguitarstudio.com. The general access membership is absolutely free to join. Come in, get your feet wet, and when you're ready, you can go for the paid membership. What you'll discover in there is the most comprehensive guitar curriculum available online. In exercise two, we're going to be looking at hand control and picking variations and also sustain concepts. Now, holding tones for sustain, when you're playing through mixed scale phrases and arpeggio outlines, it requires a little bit higher degree of fretting hand control there. So there's some pretty good perfection there on that fretting hand to do it properly and have a nice sound. And when it's applied, you know, this skill building process is often combined with repeated down or upstrokes. Sometimes we call that rake technique, or sometimes we call it sweep techniques, but whatever you choose to call it, the movement really helps notes used in a passage just flow across the arpeggiated tones a lot more effectively, smoother, you know. And from a technical standpoint, you know, phrases like this can really present some challenges too, so you have to be well aware of the skill involved to execute it, you know, as fine as you would like it in your songs. Now, in example 2A, these principles are going to be applied between fourth and second strings using repeated upstrokes, and in exercise example 2B, the practice drill just operates between fifth and third strings using some repeated downstroke motion. So let's just begin by looking at how each of these is operating, starting with exercise 2A. Now, what we're doing here is we're working between the fourth and second string. We're going to start as it's written from the G tone on the fifth fret of the fourth string, and we're going to walk up that string, G, A, B flat. Then once we reach that B flat at the 8th fret of the 4th string, we're going to lay our fingers down and have some sustain occur there. But then we're also going to have the sustain last while we come back. And on the backward notes of going again through the 3rd and 4th strings, we're going to do a sweep upwards across two guitar strings, like an economy picking concept there. But then we're going to wrap things up by just heading back to that G tone. Really, it's kind of an interesting idea because what we're doing is we're walking up a G minor scale phrase here, G, A, B flat. And then at that B flat, you can hear those tones the way they come together there. It's a diminished sound, but it's got that major third. There's your diminished sound. So major interval with a flat five, and then back down. So kind of interesting color there. But the trick to it, I mean, this is the hard part, is going along and then sustaining. So you have the bleed over of the tones back to your root note. And then, of course, too, there's that sweeping idea between, or I should really just call it an economy picked idea between those two strings with the upstroke travel there. Now, that was in fifth position, but of course, these types of exercises are really best done movable. So move them all around the neck. You know, you can even eventually, if you want to, start changing strings. I'll take it to fifth. I could even take it to third. Everywhere you move it around to and try it in a different spot with, though, it's going to feel quite different to your hand. I wouldn't do, again, very long periods of work on this because you will start to get hand pain. You have to remember, when you're practicing guitar technique, you cannot overdo it. I might make some of these look very easy, but I've practiced a lot of these kinds of drills for literally decades. You know, I started playing guitar when I was a kid. I was 8 years old, you know, and then I kind of got real serious about it when I was around 12 or 13 and, you know, just went crazy on it when I was around 16, 17, 18. At age 19, I moved to Hollywood, California, and I attended the Guitar Institute of Technology and, you know, went bananas there, you know, like, so there's so much background work for me to, you know, to play this stuff. It might look kind of easy, but you got to remember where I'm coming from. Now, for you to try this stuff, if you find it extremely difficult, really pay a ton of attention to your hand. And if you start getting a little bit of pain, you know, a little bit of funny feeling, maybe even some numbness. I had a student this week, actually, in my private classes. He's telling me that his pinky is getting kind of numb, and I was asking him, what are you practicing? What's your direction with a lot of the work you're doing? And he said, well, I'm just, you know, I'm doing like a lot of drills and exercises and scale runs and stuff. And, you know, I'm spending, you know, I think he said he spent 45 minutes the other day. I said, man, that's too long. That's just way too much work. I mean, you got to pace yourself severely in a practice schedule to be able to have the kind of balance on the muscle groups that you need, because it's one thing to go crazy and, you know, think that that's going to cause, you know, some fantastic things to happen, but you got to spread that time out. You know, you can't go too bananas, you know, for too long, because you're going to start getting problems, hand pain, maybe even numbness, like I said, all kinds of stuff. Anyway, let's move on though right now, sorry, to example 2B. This exercise is working between the fifth and third strings as it's written. And what we're doing here is we're moving across a major triad. I have an F major triad that's going across here. So I'm going, you know, across 8th to 7th to 5th, and then I'm moving forward, and then I'm getting a note that's coming in after that on the 4th string, creating a pattern that's an arpeggio, so in this case it's E flat. So I've kind of got like an F major, and then I'm going through an E flat major. And then let's try and move it around, take it someplace else. I'll take it off of a G now. Maybe I'll move it down here to a D. And you know, at any time you could, you know, practice changing it up, maybe take it to another guitar string. Maybe take it down low off 6th. But, you know, you could, you know, just take it all over the neck eventually. You know, maybe turn on a metronome and find a pace and then begin moving them incrementally along the fingerboard. But it's kind of a fun one. It's really just kind of two different major arpeggios. But we have that one note that's sort of a connecting concept on the uppermost part of it. We're moving forward by way of a half step. So, you know, fool around with this one. It's quite a nice one. And we're doing that rake technique too with the pick, dropping down. We're wanting those notes to let them ring out. But, you know, from a perspective of a real sweep, you know, it's really... Each note is kind of getting a little bit of its own color. So remember that, you know, the way you're executing a sweep or a rake, it's just dependent upon what kind of end result sound that you want out of the guitar. In our case, for this exercise, what we're trying to do is sustain. So we want those notes ringing. It's going to help you with your technique on fretting out sections of melodies that need to ring out, and then maybe after that part, you'll have another single note line phrase after it. All right, so that is exercise 2A and 2B. So now you have four different ideas that you can mess around with, all building different perspectives. You know, we had some, you know, two-string studies with left and right-hand balancing concepts we were talking about in exercise 1. And then in exercise 2, this was really about the hand control concept, coming up with some kinds of picking variations and then having some sustain behind them as well. So we're training our hands to be sort of glued down onto the fingerboard while we go across notes and generate sounds, you know, with notes ringing out. So that's taking care of two concepts that we have up front in lesson 1 here of guitar technique, drills for hand function and control. And that brings us to the end of part 1. Now, in the members area of my website, in part two, what we're going to be looking at in this lesson plan is some nice in-position fretting concepts where we'll skip over some strings and have some work where we do ideas where notes will sort of bounce over and across. So I'll be able to jump across some notes. We'll also take a look at some statements that apply vertical jumps, you know, where we'll do a part of a line in one area and then jump. You know what I mean? So we'll come up with parts that will flip around from one zone of the guitar neck into another, and that's going to be some good work for just performing fingerboard ideas that operate in groupings and have shifting that occurs all over the fretboard. Now, like I mentioned, these are going to be available in the members area at creativeguitarstudio.com. If you don't yet have a membership to Creative Guitar Studio, hit to the site and, you know, grab at least a free membership. There's 30 free lessons in the quick licks area, and then if you decide to upgrade, you can get a basic or you get a premium membership plan, and that'll take you to the next level. A lot of people are really on the site for the courses and some of the other electives that I have. So, you know, check it out. Go and get a free membership. You don't need a credit card number or anything like that. Just set up a username and a password with your email, and we'll get you all rigged up in there, and you can start checking up the site and see what's going on, what kind of ideas in there are interesting to you. And eventually, if you want to start studying the courses that I got for the introductory, intermediate, and advanced, you can certainly sign up for a membership plan and get going on those. If you have any questions, just send me an email off the website. I'd be happy to help you. And if you have other questions, you can always try calling me through the day in my studio office. I'm usually around most of the day. If I'm not in, please leave a message and I'll get right back to you. So thanks for checking out this first half of the video. I look forward to following up with exercises 3 and 4 in the members area with you. The Blues Guitar Styles ebook is a masterclass course covering a huge amount of information on the blues style. With 8, 12, and 16 bar blues progressions, classic blues styles, plus all the important chord patterns. There's over 50 pages of information, including sections on blues techniques like slide, alternate tuning, and bending. This ebook has everything the guitar player needs for a solid foundation in blues guitar, including 27 MP3 audio tracks for easy at-home study. Blues Guitar Styles is available for instant download in the View Our Products area at creativeguitarstudio.com. Thanks for watching part one of the lesson. Be sure to sign up for a membership at creativeguitarstudio.com to watch part two. In part two, we're going to study position fretting techniques and the application of vertical jumps. Plus, as a member, you'll also be able to download the handout for this lesson, along with many more professional guitar lessons. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch up next in the members area.